Sports.
Yes, yes, tis the season. Welcome to another episode of Stuff About Sports. I'm Germ. With me, as always, my guy Bert. What's up, man?
What's going on, dude? The layout looks great, and that bumper video, that remix just got me in the mood for some holidays. Like, let's go.
I know. I'm so excited. There's a lot to be thankful for this Christmas season. The NBA is officially back right now. The Brooklyn Nets are putting it on the Golden State Warriors. We have NFL playoffs are ahead. It's shaping up. We have some NBA news on top of the season starting today. And we will also give our favorite holiday sports moments that come with the snow and Christmas. So if any of you are listening live, please jump in the comment section. Jump in with your favorite Christmas Day games, your favorite moments in sports you may remember from your childhood. It doesn't have to be on Christmas. Anything that has to do with winter, anything that has to do with the December games or January games, whatever. Please hit us up. Also, at the end of the show, we will give our top five favorite holiday movies. I know it's not a sports topic, but it is the season. We want to give you something to watch with your families and do something a little different on the show. Before we get started with the NFL, just wanted to give a quick announcement. A lot of you have been asking. Yes, we do have some technical issues with our Stuff About Sports main page. We are sorting that out. Hopefully we can get that resolved in the next week or so. But until then, please join the Stuff About Sports, the official Stuff About Sports fan group. We were planning to do that anyway. We wanted to create a space for our fans to get in there and make their own topics and debate with us, you know. But it's for you. Please, you don't have to wait for me to post anything. You don't have to wait for Bert to post anything. You post whatever you want to post that's sports related, anything that has to do with Stuff About Sports. There's a bunch of stuff going on right now. So until then, we will get into it. Yeah, Brandon, don't worry, buddy. In our winner and loser segment, you could take a wild guess where where you guys are going. And yes, if you are watching, don't change your sets. We are Airbnb-ing at the Divides page because our page is not. And John, what's up, man? What's up? Thank you for coming by. Appreciate you. So let's get started. NFL kicked off. Bert, NFL is almost over. The regular season is almost over.
Yeah.
And I can't believe how fast the season has gone, to be honest with you. So why don't you get us started with your first winner and loser?
Oh, it's going to be your first winner right off the gate, the Buffalo Bills. And here's why. Not only did I keep them in the bucket of doom, knowing that they were going to put in work this weekend, but clinch the division. And you like to see where they're headed, 11-3. 2 weeks left heading into undoubtedly what is set to be a good playoff run. And I know we were texting on Saturday when that game was going on. And you said they're going to meet the Chiefs in the AFC Championship. And at this point, what other team can you argue would take that spot? We obviously know the Chiefs are probably going to blow through their competition. But if you look in that division, the Bills have one of the most explosive offenses that are now, it's a well-oiled machine. Everybody's healthy. Josh Allen looks like Josh Allen, the God right now. And He's using Diggs. He's using Beasley. He's honestly, they've hit a stride and they look scary. So look, they are certainly headed in the right direction. They are my winner. And I cannot wait to see what the next couple of weeks brings going into the playoffs too, because I have high hopes for them. I have high hopes for you as a fan too.
Listen, man, you have no idea. I mean, you have an idea because we were texting on Saturday, but I mean, it's been 25 years. Okay. You understand? I'm 33 years old. I was a child. Coming into my fandom, my grandfather was a Buffalo Bills fan. So I was a Buffalo Bills fan. He took me to my first game up at the Ralph. And, you know, Thurman Thomas was my favorite player. And, you know, by the time I came into my own, the Bills were awful and they've been awful. And so to have this feeling, it's an amazing feeling. It's the organization is finally run well. We finally have a quarterback. And you're right. The Bills are playing just as well as the Chiefs are. I could argue even better just based on the level of competition we have faced over the season and the level of competition they have faced, right? Mm-hmm. And as it shapes out, you know, think about Patrick Mahomes' skill set. Josh Allen can literally do everything Patrick Mahomes can do and maybe a little bit better. Mm-hmm. I think Josh Allen is more athletic. I think Josh Allen has a stronger arm. He's by far has a stronger arm. The problem with Josh Allen was his accuracy, and he seems to have fixed it. Now, yes, Patrick Mahomes is more accurate, but the drop-off isn't, you know, based on what I've seen this year, not that far off. Mm-hmm. And as I said last week, Patrick Mahomes gets the benefit of having Tyreek Hill and Travis Kelce. And yes, we have Stephon Diggs. We don't have a real good running game. We don't have any really good tight ends, but Josh Allen just had an NFL, season-leading record, passing to 13 touchdown passes to different people. I mean, so Josh Allen has the skills and he's doing all the talking and he's doing all the walking and I love it.
Yeah, he reminds me of kind of like Aaron Rodgers still to this day, right? I mean, you know, anybody who Aaron Rodgers is throwing to, or even you can even throw Tom Brady in there, anybody that he's throwing to is going to get that good look and that good pass. Dude, that pass he dropped in to Diggs was, I think that's right as I was texting you. It was unreal, dude. It was picture perfect. And I mean, I honestly wish I was still in my fantasy playoffs because I have both Diggs and Beasley and I would have been starting both of them and they just went off. So certainly a huge win in my winner column this week goes to the Bills. Loser, and I think this should be brought up right away, the Pittsburgh Steelers. What the fuck is
right
happening?
On time, Brandon. Right on time.
Yeah.
Sorry,
what is going on? Like what is happening? And granted, we've heard the arguments from you and many other people. Mm-hmm. They had a soft schedule. This is what you expected off the schedule, but like to drop three in a row like this. And we said it 2 weeks ago, that team did not look the same. And at first we thought, all right, well, you know what? They've been playing three games in 12, 13 days. Maybe they're just tired, but this is really no excuse, especially losing to the Bengals. They honestly are not looking good.
Oh my God.
They are an 11-3 team right now that it wouldn't shock me if they lost first round of the playoffs.
I'll go even a step further. They're going to lose this division.
Really? Oh yeah, they could. Mm-hmm.
Cleveland is only a game back. They have to play Cleveland in week 17. Mm-hmm. Cleveland has easier opponents leading up to that final game. They're trending up. Pittsburgh's trending down.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brandon. I was just about to say that. Yes. Big Ben looks awful.
Yes.
I don't know what it is. It's the receivers. It's hard to blame the receivers when the quarterback is clearly not playing well. Mm-hmm. You know, so yes, I can. Now, Deontay Johnson had a lot of drops against the Bills. You know, a lot of those drops were good passes. So I'm not going to put that game. I think the Bills are just simply better than the Steelers. But so when I look at that game, you know, I looked at, okay, Ben. Even outside of Deontay Johnson, Ben just didn't look right. He's just a shell of himself. He can't move in out of the pocket. I said this, listening back two shows ago when I laid all this out, I said, man, the Steelers aren't it, man. But, you know, and so Washington's one story, okay? They have a good defense. Mm-hmm. They're shaping up to be a top 10 defense. And so their offense just does enough, gets lucky enough to win some of these close games. But there is no excuse to lose to the Bengals.
There absolutely isn't.
And they didn't lose to the Bengals. They got their ass kicked by the
Bengals.
They
did. And it was a lack of the, I'm sorry to cut you off. It was lack of their offense getting anything going as a result of Ben not looking himself or even performing as his old self. And you got to think, I mean, he was in the same class as Eli and Rivers. At least Rivers looks like he was breathing new life out there in Indianapolis. But Ben, he's on the back end. And we know he's been plagued with injuries of years past. You know, he fell off his motorcycle. I mean, he's taken a beating throughout his career. I think it's time. I think this year should be his last year overall. What I will say is as exciting is as much as the Steelers are sucking right now, that means in 2 weeks or a week and a half, however you want to look at it, the very last game of the season when they do play the Browns, it looks like it will be for that division. So we're going to have exciting, meaningful football all the way down to the wire for them because the Browns have the Jets this week. And the Steelers have the Colts. So, I mean, the way the Steelers have been playing, there's no question that the Colts are absolutely going to ruin them. You know, it's battle the old man quarterbacks in that one. But the Browns should hand it to the Jets. Although I don't want to put the Jets in my winner column this week because I won't, because I think they're doing it wrong. Why start winning now? It's ridiculous when you could just honestly, I know nobody wants to tank, but like, let's be honest, you should have just not showed up. You know, how do you lose a game like you do to Seattle a couple weeks ago?
Right.
And then come in and win last week like you did. It's like, do you want Trevor Lawrence or no? You know?
So let's talk about that. I was going to put the Jets in my loser column for that reason, but then I thought about that. I'm going to put them in my winner column because it's the only time they'd ever were going to be on there. The same people that were criticizing the Jets for doing the zero blitz are the same ones criticizing them for winning the game. You can't have it both ways. Okay. Nobody wants to be associated with 0-16. I get what's on the line. And I started looking at some of this stuff. They're still probably going to get the number one pick. I know it's like them or the Jags or however, you want to, you know, whatever. But, you know, is Trevor Lawrence a guy that you think is immediate? Is he in like the Andrew Luck? Like, is he being touted like he's going to come in and be the man? No, he just happens to be the best quarterback out of a bunch of other quarterbacks in college. But wait. There's more, right? I looked at some of the numbers. There's a guy out there named Justin Fields. The drop off from Trevor Lawrence and Justin Fields isn't that like, so what my point is, Trevor Lawrence isn't Andrew Luck, right? He isn't like the ultimate, like he's just a guy who's been in a lot of big games. So people know his name. So it's like one of those things where, like I was saying last week with like Aaron Rodgers and Patrick Mahomes, they just see him a lot because he's exposed a lot. So they're automatically just going to throw his name out there. But when you look at some of the numbers and some of these other quarterbacks, the drop-off isn't like that. And I don't think Trevor Lawrence is going to be one of the top five quarterbacks in the next 3 years. That's, you know, you thought about that. Like when you draft a quarterback number one and you're trying to put Trevor Lawrence in that class, that's how I'm thinking about it. No, when Andrew Luck was drafted, I'm like, yeah, he's going to be a top five quarterback immediately. You know, I thought about that about Baker. I, as a Bills fan, I wanted the Bills to trade up for Baker. I thought he was ready. Now he had some ups and downs and it's looking great now, but I'm really happy with how it worked out with Josh Allen. But like even Trevor Lawrence wasn't touted higher like Baker Mayfield was.
Yeah.
You know, shit, not even maybe like I think the only guy, you know, Johnny Manziel had the hype like Trevor Lawrence has, but nobody expected Johnny Manziel to be like the man. So the Jets. You know, I get it. They were going to win a game, and it just happened to be this one. I don't like the people that are killing them for winning a game when they were like, oh, you watch a zero blitz and cost yourself the game and shit like that. I don't like that.
Yeah, well, the same people are criticizing for winning are the same ones that obviously think the Jags are going to walk away with Trevor Lawrence. And when you look, when you're in that franchise position where you're a fan and you're literally looking at an 0-16 or, you know, or 1-16 or 0-17 season, it's not good. But at least you can hang your hat on the fact that you're going to get the number one QB and hoping that fixes everything. Now, could he be a top five? Who knows? We've been pleasantly surprised, but I will say if you're going to draft a quarterback in that spot, you better plan on him being the franchise guy and build around him, which I'll pivot to my next winner, even though they lost.
Wait, before you go, if you're Trevor Lawrence, would you rather go to the Jags or the Jets?
Or the Jags.
Okay.
That is what it is. The Jets, I mean, you can look at the Jets history of just mismanagement, and the Jags have at least they've been competitive when they needed to be, and their owner knows how to hire the right people to be competitive. The Jets is just a never ending cycle of getting kicked in the balls. That's basically what it is. If someone can point to me, aside from the Rex Ryan, Mark Sanchez days, and they had what, two good years out of that, where else in history can they point to being successful?
Gotcha. Yeah, you know? I just wanted to make sure I wasn't crazy. I think I would choose the Jaguars as well.
Yeah, the ownership just knows how to put management in the right positions from GM all the way down to scouts for the Jags. Now they're having a terrible season now, but that doesn't mean they're not going to rebound. So I have full faith in them from there. But going on to my next winner, that is actually a loser. I'm actually going with the Philadelphia Eagles.
Whoa.
And here's why.
Whoa.
Yes. Because it is Jalen Hurts time. And his first game, we were like, okay, a little shaky. Let's see how he settles in. He played very well. He kept up with Kyler. 338, three touchdowns, looked good to the point that Carson Wentz has his tail between his legs, huffing and puffing as though if, you know, if I'm not the starter, then I want out. And you know what, Carson? That's the biggest fucking baby response I've ever heard in my life. If you want to be the starter, how about you fucking work for it? How about you be the best quarterback on the team? None of this, I signed a big deal, therefore I'm owed the position. Like this, that's the biggest baby attitude I think I've ever seen in my life. And guess what? You're going to go somewhere else and you're still not going to be successful because you're an average at best quarterback. So Jalen Hurts and the Eagles get in the winner column for me despite their loss, because overall it's good to see that kid under center and just doing good things, especially to stick it to Carson Wentz, who I know we've talked about plenty of times on this show.
Yeah.
Steelers
going to get.
Nah. Would you want Carson Wentz in Pittsburgh after having Big Ben? I mean, I don't know. I don't see it.
The Steelers, you know what the Steelers need to do? The Steelers need to ride out Mason Rudolph for 1 year and be bad or be whatever they're going to be and draft whatever that next quarterback's going to be and just be done with it. Carson Wentz is probably destined for Indianapolis or something like that. But we'll see. Carson Wentz, the teams always get better when he's not there. So I, you know, take that for what you will. It's not his fault that they gave him that money, but you know, he's not good. Like, I don't know what to tell you. Like, he's one of those guys. Again, like I said, people get hooked on potential too much instead of the facts. And you know, he's not good, and he's shown you that he's not good, and people need to stop, you know, saying what he's going to be instead of what he's already been. So it's over for Carson Wentz.
Oh, yeah.
So my loser is the Washington football team. And if you haven't heard this yet, they took a loss to Seattle, a good loss, because there was nothing to hang their heads. That's Seattle. And even with Dwayne Haskins, who was awful as well, they still almost won the game. They had a chance there to win the game, and Dwayne Haskins just isn't good. So that's how that happens. But Dwayne Haskins was then caught at a strip club after the game, after losing, no mask on. Now, listen, before I am pro stripper. I am pro strip club. I have no issue with a grown person, and I'm not a COVID Nazi. I'm not sitting here on a pedestal wagging my finger at people. If you want to go out and enjoy yourself, please do. However, I'm a proponent and champion of the rules, especially in a game or on a team like football, right? I'm a firefighter. I was in the military. I believe in having your guys back and chain of command and following the rules, because these are your orders, right? What you do doesn't affect just yourself. It affects your team or your comrades or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
There are strict COVID rules, Dwayne Haskins, and you didn't follow them. And now guess what's going to happen? You're probably going to get suspended for 4 games. Oh, there's not 4 games left in the season unless you guys win the division. Mm-hmm. But guess what, buddy? Kyle Allen, the real backup, has an ACL injury. He's done for the season. Your starting quarterback, Alex Smith, has a calf strain on the leg that had like necrophilia, you know, whatever the neck flesh-eating disease is called, right? Mm-hmm. Has some shit on there. He's not 100%. You are literally all they have. Your team is winning the division right now. Why would you risk your team missing the playoffs to go look at some ass? Bro, if you don't hop on Xbox or if you don't go on Bang Bros and just sit your ass at home and wait till the season's over, it doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. You know, it just doesn't make sense. You got that from me when you're a Mason. It's the logical thing, Kaz. I think me and you are just single-mindedly geniuses that see the common sense in things. Let me tell you something. Dak ain't going nowhere, buddy. I'll tell you that right now. The best thing that happened to Dak Prescott was to tear his ACL. He's getting that money from Dallas. But mark my words, buddy, he ain't going nowhere. Jerry Jones is keeping
it. I got to be honest with you. If he doesn't, though, I can see him in with Pittsburgh.
I mean, yeah. I don't know if they have a history of, like, paying big time free agents like that. They're like one of those old timey. But we have Steeler fans in there. If I'm wrong, please correct me, Steeler fans. Are you guys willing to spend crazy amounts of money on Dak Prescott? Like I don't know how that works. But Dwayne Haskins costing your team possibly the division, which means the playoffs is bad. That's why you guys lost this week.
I mean, if you look at it, they have the Panthers this weekend, and then they finish up against the Eagles. So they honestly have a strong chance to win the division. The Giants host Baltimore, or they're in Baltimore this weekend, and then they finish up against Dallas. So honestly, if I were to pick who's really going to battle it out for that, I mean, shit, it honestly could come down to Dallas and the Giants on that last game, depending on what Washington does. As I don't see the Eagles even getting up to compete, but hey, I could be wrong. It's still so very neck and neck. And the Eagles have Dallas this weekend. So, I mean, look, who knows what's going to happen, but yeah, I mean, shame on you, Haskins. That's just not good. You have a chance to actually, granted, that entire division is an absolute dumpster fire, but at least you have a chance to get into the playoffs. So why wouldn't you want to give the best opportunity to compete? Like you said, I mean, Jesus, go on the internet, go anywhere, just pull out your phone. You can pull up your phone for fuck's sake. Yeah. Like, come on. So in keeping within the division, loser this week for me is the New York Giants. And yes, going up against, you know, Baker Mayfield, and a hot Browns team, unfortunately, me as a Giant fan, hoping that they, of course, would pull out the win and actually give me a little bit more faith towards the end of the season that they're going to have some extra football at the end of the year. But unfortunately, didn't even do it. It's one of those games where they just could not generate the offense. And, you know, I have to kind of just attribute it to just lack of an offensive line. You obviously had Daniel Jones sitting out again, so Colt McCoy's in, and they just couldn't get anything going whatsoever. So, unfortunate to them, they 20-6 was the end result. And again, we're going up against the Browns, who have been hot past couple of weeks, but overall the Giants just look like complete garbage, plain and simple. So they're my loser, just surely out of my own heartbreak.
Coming off a 33-27 win over the Minnesota Vikings, my loser is the Chicago Bears.
Loser.
Yeah. Loser. You know why? Because another Chicago Bears win means Mitch Trubisky is still the starter in Chicago. And that is the worst possible thing that could happen. We know we are cheap. No, so those are our resident Steelers fans. So yeah, I wouldn't hold my breath for Dak Prescott. That's what I thought. I didn't think that they would be in the Dak Prescott sweepstakes. But yeah, Mitch Trubisky, definition of pedestrian, 15 for 21, mm-hmm. 200 yards, one touchdown, one interception, and another win where, again, what, like I always said, he just gives you that Mitch Trubisky kid. You know, he might be that guy. Mm-hmm. He's not. But this is going to keep happening, and he's going to be the starter next year, and the Bears are just going to be mediocre, man. It's the worst thing to be 8-8 in the league. I'd rather, you know, the Jets are doing it right. The Jags are doing it right. 1-15, 0-16. You know, the Chiefs are doing it right. 12-1 or whatever the hell they are, and 10-11-3 and all the, you know, the good teams. 8-8. You know, 500 is literally the worst position you could be, because you can't get better decisively. You can't get worse decisively unless you go out there and just tank. You know, it's not the system's fault, but that's just the system that's in place. So I feel so bad for Chicago Bears fans. That's awful to suffer another year of going into the 2021 season with Mitch Trubisky.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, look, that's honestly all I had for my winners and losers, to be honest with you. I mean, you could touch upon like more of the obvious ones, but and it's like, you know, obviously that the Pats tanking, and then you can go right on back into how the Brady versus Belichick, and how Brady is just is winning that matchup completely.
Ding, ding, ding.
I think Bill Belichick is literally just thrown in the towel. At this point, it's just over. Oh, 100% for the season. But I mean, how do you not reflect on that? Not only for your fan base, but also ownership too. And Robert Kraft being like, dude, what the fuck happened? Like you can't even look at the season and say they were competitive, because they weren't.
No, they had like maybe two good games, like games where you're like, oh, okay. But I'll tell you what happened. Jimmy Garoppolo happened. Robert Kraft loved Tom Brady, has a boner for Tom Brady. Mm-hmm. Bill Belichick, track record of getting rid of guys a year early, knows the system, knows what he wants to do. Wanted Jimmy Garoppolo. Robert Kraft said no. So Bill Belichick traded him to San Francisco. So don't be surprised if there is an offseason trade to bring Jimmy Graps back to New England.
San Fran signed Josh Rosen?
San Fran is probably going to draft a quarterback.
Okay.
They're one of those teams that's probably going to do the Matt Ryan. I wouldn't be surprised if San Fran tries to do the Matt Ryan thing, save him. You know, Falcons got to blow that thing up. The Falcons have to blow that situation up down there. It's over. And reuniting Matt Ryan with Shanahan while they try to figure out their future QB, because it ain't Nick Mullins. It ain't whoever else is on that team. Maybe they could figure that out. I know the Cowboys. I put the Cowboys in my winner column. They had a pretty big win with the Red Rifle there. But put up 40 points. Ezekiel Elliott, it's over for you, buddy. Tony Pollard has arrived. So, yeah, the Cowboys in my winner's column. So that's my last winner. But, week 15, like I said, I'll be honest with you. My Bills won. I don't give a shit what happened.
Dude, they won too. They won on a Saturday, which means Sunday you were just like, fuck, I don't care. Like, red the zone, whole NFL could burn. Yeah. I do not give a shit.
I had red zone on, and it just was on. I was just floating around. Real bad. That's a culture. That's a coaching thing. Mm-hmm. That's establishing a culture. That's your veterans who have PTSD over the Super Bowl not getting over it. And once you, it's one of those things where, like, if you fail a test and you get to do the retest, you're more nervous about the retest because you have already failed it. Mm-hmm. And then it's like that. So I feel bad for Matt Ryan. I feel bad for Julio Jones, who had to suffer through Matt Ryan. I said for years Matt Ryan was no good. I'm sorry. Matt Ryan is good. He is not as elite and as, you know, great as what he's always been made out to be. He's just always been a good quarterback to me. But people have this guy in the Hall of Fame, and they kept putting him up as a top quarterback in the league because he throws a lot of touchdowns in garbage time because his team's always losing because he's not good. And so, you guys can start listening to me around here because I know what's going on.
Well, I mean, you're right. I mean, if you think about it, aside from their Super Bowl run, I mean, pretty much every other year it was an early exit of, like, first round of the playoffs, notably to the Giants at least 2 years in a row. So it's one of those things where, he puts up the numbers and he's consistent throughout the regular season. But if you're not taking your team, then, I mean, how can you be called elite and how are you in that status, you know?
So as we jump off that, let's get into some holiday cheer.
Okay? Yes.
Tis the season, and we're giving out gifts all throughout the sportsdom. Mm-hmm. So we want to know from you guys, what gift would you give a player or a franchise or even the broad range of sports? Bert, do you want to go first here? Because I have one ready to go.
I will absolutely go first. Touching on it, it's a little bit more recent. And so Henrik Lundqvist was the goaltender for the Rangers for, I think it was like 12 or 14 seasons. He recently signed a one-year contract. The Rangers bought out the last year of his contract. He signed a one-year deal with the Capitals, was preparing for the season. And unfortunately, last week he revealed as though he has a heart condition and can't play. So I'm starting this off on a nice note. I want to give Henrik a new heart. We don't know what the severity is of the condition. All we know is he's not cleared to play and he has to take this season off and he can't play for the Caps anymore. And despite the fact that he left my favorite team to go play against a very competitive team in itself, he's still an all-around fantastic athlete, great ambassador for the game, and he will always have a very special place in Rangers fans' hearts. I just want to be able to fix that so he can compete again, because he's that good where I think he should go to a good team and compete for a championship, because that's the one thing he's missing. He has the gold medals. He has the Vezina trophy, which is like the MVP goaltender trophy in the NHL. Yeah. So I think he deserves a shot at the championship, and fixing that will get him there.
That's really deep. I know who that is. He's, just following you guys, knowing you're Rangers fans and just being from the Northeast, I know how great he is. That's tough, man. I hope he gets that figured out. Michael, Mets got one. It's Uncle Stevie. You're damn right. It's Uncle Stevie. Yeah. Yeah. We're coming for you, Yankees. All right. Mm-hmm. You're not the biggest penis at the table anymore. Uncle Stevie here. All right. So, give Juju a flip phone. Absolutely. What is happening with that? Like, he didn't learn his lesson. Apparently he says he's been doing it all season. I don't remember him doing it, but it's one of those. Okay, fine. Great. You were winning against bad teams then.
That's the thing.
Losing. Stop dancing on the logo. It's just one. I mean, I'm surprised Tomlin lets him do it anyway, but I guess if you're winning, it's cool. But it's just one of those things. If you're winning, we're going to tolerate it. And we're losing, hey, knock that shit off. You know what I mean? It's just, it doesn't do you any favors, especially when you're not playing well. He got rocked yesterday on Sunday by the Bengals. So that's always great to see. I love that. I love seeing players get their comeuppance when they do something like that. So
yeah,
my gift to the NBA is expanding the three-point line. I would take away the corner three and I would make the arch a half circle and expand it to the sideline. So there is no more corner three, which is the short, is the easiest shot in the game statistically. It's a shorter three-pointer than any other. This way, the three-pointers are all the same distance apart and it's back a little bit. And I think that would make for more competitive basketball, and it would stop these people from just jacking up, you know, running to the corner and standing there and giving us this unwatchable brand of basketball. So my gift to the NBA is expanding and moving the three-point line out to the sideline and eliminating the corner three.
Love it. I certainly want to enhance some games and give a gift. And I'm all about baseball and I'm all about runs, specifically home runs. So my gift would be the designated hitter for the AL and NL Universal.
Yes.
Let's go.
Yes.
What's better than watching guys in whatever league that you're in just hit fucking dingers out the park left and right? I don't want to watch some pitcher get up to bat and know that he's, oh, maybe, you know, ground out to first, or maybe hopefully he'll even make contact. Who wants to see that? Oh, and the off chance he goes yard. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, sure. Let me watch a pitcher, you know, let's say out of 20 pitchers taking bat, let's say that, I get one home run every, 4 weeks? No, that's stupid. I'd rather see dudes go absolutely yard and smash balls out the park every single game than on the off chance a pitcher hits one. So you know what, MLB, my gift to you, Universal DH. You did it this year. Let's do it again.
My gift to sports is eliminating ties. I'm tired of ties, soccer, hockey. Give out points to these guys and stop. Make them give extra points. Play until the fucking game's over. Play until there's a winner.
Well, hockey changed that. So
hockey did change that. So hockey, people, soccer. You, I know.
NFL.
NFL. So no, you can still end in a tie though. We have a tie, right? We have a tie.
Oh, yeah. So what I'm saying is, soccer in the NFL, they need to get rid of that.
Oh, they need to get rid of that.
That's not a gift, Mike. Mets fans don't like DH.
Don't worry. We're going to find out. We're going to see what a lot, you know, once the Mets get those black jerseys and everybody's, we're going to be Gotham City yet again. And don't worry, the baseball's going to run through, City Field.
So I like the divide boys are in here tonight.
I know. We're using their feed. We're going to pollute their feed with this DH. We're going to start a revolt down here. No ties in hockey. Obviously, I'm not a hockey fan, but Bert set me straight. But you know what I mean? Ties from everything. Get rid of ties for everything. There shouldn't be ties in sports. I don't believe in that. That's bullshit. Play till the game's over. So my gift to sports is eliminating the ties. Real simple. Play extra quarters if you have to. Sudden death. I'm not a fan of sudden death, but play extra quarters and just keep playing until it's over. So that's my gift.
My gift is for the Giants specifically. I want to give them an offensive line so they can at least be competitive next year. They're absolutely fucking atrocious. This is a problem we've had for absolutely years. And for some reason, they can't build a strong offensive line. So can please someone just give the Giants more money, sign more. I don't care what it is, but an offensive line.
I don't know what that is.
It's a movie. It's Sudden Death is a movie with Jean-Claude Van Damme. It's actually a hockey. He plays like some detective and there are terrorists trying to blow up the game. And there's a bomb that's timed to go off at the end of the game and it goes into overtime.
Oh my God.
And all throughout the movie, he's just looking for this bomb. And I think it was the Igloo, the old Pittsburgh Penguins arena too. You should watch it. It's entertaining, you know?
I went on a Jackie Chan, movie binge the other day. I went nuts. Who Am I is my favorite Jackie Chan movie. I know it's a, like, it's a low key one. A lot of people don't know which one that is. He has amnesia and he's like some super badass. He doesn't know he is, but he's just going around Hong Kong kicking ass for no reason. Who Am I? Jackie Chan. I suggest it. Has one of the greatest fight scenes ever in a Jackie Chan or any martial arts movie. Up on the rooftop, he's fighting like this handsome ass Swedish dude who's actually super duper nice. Listen, I'm in the minority, literally the minority here. I don't know what that is. I'm gonna find it. Thank you for putting me on to sudden death. I had one more winner here and that I wanted to get rid of, and or not winner, I'm sorry, Christmas gift. And this is the biggest one, the biggest gift I can give to anybody, because stuff about sports is for the kids. And so for the kids, I give the gift of paying the college players. Pay the players. Scholarship, bullshit. Nobody cares about the dude majoring in home ec. That's not an education. These dudes are taking these basic ass classes. I hate when people say, oh, they're getting a free ride to school. You think they're fucking going to class? What do you think they're taking? Did they're in class to be like engineers? No, they're taking like some basic ass, general ass courses. This isn't like the 1950s where like a full scholarship meant something. The scholarship doesn't mean anything. They're giving out scholarships for fucking chess players now. Who cares? Pay these guys. You guys are making billions of dollars. These kids are putting their career. We had just had the Florida guy, Keontae Johnson. Almost die for your Florida basketball. For what? For him to get a plaque on the wall? Like, no, pay these players, pay them so they don't have to, we don't have to go through these boosters and all this illegal bullshit. It's time to elevate and advance and evolve this thing. College sports makes way too much money. You know, you can pay the players something. Nobody's saying make these college kids millionaires. You know, they can make a couple tens of thousands of dollars to get through school or whatever, you know. At least let them, maybe if you don't want the university setting that precedent of paying them directly, allow them to go out, and if a car dealership wants to pay him to make a commercial or, you know, put his face on his car dealership and pay him to do that, let him do it. Who gives a shit?
Sell their jerseys, sell the likeness to it. I mean, even if you have to go through some weird holdings company or some third party to pay these kids, they deserve it. And here's why, because when you're playing, especially at that D1 level, that is your job. That's your job. And you're not, you know, no one goes to college and works for, they're giving me a full ride. But kids can still go on a full ride academically. They can go do internships. They can hold jobs. When you're a D1, think about a D1, especially football athlete. When they're not playing throughout the fall, guess what they're doing? They're training in the offseason. They hire personal trainers in the offseason to train them to get better, because their goal is to get drafted. They 365 days a year, they are watching what they eat. They're training, they're building, they are working, straight work. So yes, they 100% need to be paid. My very last gift is for all sports everywhere, is to stop testing for illegal substances up to and including steroids.
Everybody should use
performance enhancing drugs. You want to use it? Go for it. You want to risk your own health and shrinking your own balls? If you want to, go for it. Who cares? Make everything legal, and then everything is even on the playing field. Some will take it. Some won't take it. It is what it is. This kind of goes back to the DH argument. I just want to see guys perform at their highest level. And if they choose to take it to do that, that's on them. But at least, you know, there's no rules to it anymore. You don't have to worry about guys getting tested and, you know, they're doing some sort of fertility thing, so it's coming up and they're getting banned, or, you know, even illegal substances. We know the NBA is getting rid of it, but, you know, other leagues too. Stop testing for weed. Like, stop. These are grown adults. Let them make their own decision. And if that's what they're going to do to try to compete at that level, that's what they're going to do. So let's make sports great again and just make everything legal. I'm not high right now.
No. Bert is high, but not high off a substance. He's high because he is elevated thinking. Yes, get rid of it. Baseball was at its best when Mark McGwire, I'm sorry, and Sammy Sosa were doing the home run thing. Baseball was about to end up, no offense, Bert, like hockey, in purgatory, no TV deal, and they were going to be stuck on like some bullshit channel like hockey was for years, until they got that NBC deal again. It took them like 10 plus years to get back on TV. That was what baseball was headed to. Take the steroids if you want to. It makes better sport. You know who's not going to care? If my team is hitting 35 plus home runs every year, you know, getting to the championships and doing all this great shit and scoring all these points, if my best players are always healthy, and playing every week. I don't have to worry about dudes missing weeks and weeks at a time because they can't recover fast enough. They're professional athletes. I don't give a shit if they're taking steroids. Take them.
Yeah, like, go for it.
People were already taking them anyway and getting away with it. That's my whole thing. You know how many people are taking steroids right now? NBA doesn't test for steroids. You don't think LeBron James is on steroids? Look at him. He disappeared to Miami for 2 weeks. He was in a slump. Mm-hmm. His second year in LA, he was playing bad. He goes to Miami for 2 weeks. He comes back, and all of a sudden, he's playing like he's 20 years old again. The fuck do you think that was?
And he's got a new hairline.
Yeah. I mean, come on, bro. These guys are taking steroids out the ass, and I'm here for it. Yo, I want the best athletes doing the best shit all the time. I don't want to watch fucking dudes that look like me and Bert out there fumbling around. I want to see LeBron James, and I want to see these giant Derrick Henry. So you can't tell me Derrick Henry ain't out there at halftime putting horse steroids in his eyeballs.
Saquon Barkley has horse legs. His quads are huge. You're going to tell me that that's all natural substances? Like, get the fuck out of here. No way.
No. Yeah. No, Bert, me and you are on the same page, buddy. Let the steroids in. We want the DH. Expand the three-point line, pay the college players. All right, so now we're going to move on to news of the NBA day. Like I said, NBA started today. Our Sixers play tomorrow against Washington at 7, so I can't wait for that.
Yeah.
But there's news coming out that there are heightened talks at bringing up two new expansion teams to the NBA. One in Las Vegas, of course, because the NBA is at the forefront of sports betting, and the other one, as I am so happy to hear, Seattle. A lot of people who follow the NBA closely know that Seattle already had a basketball team, the Seattle Supersonics. They drafted Kevin Durant and Russell Westbrook. They played there for a year, their rookie years, and then that was it. Or no, they didn't draft Westbrook. They drafted Westbrook the year they moved to OKC. So he actually never suited up for the Supersonics. But they had Kevin Durant for 1 year with Jeff Green and Rashard Lewis at a time. But Seattle has been desperate for a basketball team. People have wanted it for years. They left to go down to Oklahoma City after Oklahoma City hosted the New Orleans Hornets. After the New Orleans Hornets left Charlotte, which became the Bobcats. So it was a big game of musical chairs with all the teams. Well, now Adam Silver is trying to bring back sometime after the pandemic. There's not a hard date. There's not any concrete plans. It's just, hey, when we expand, it is going to be Las Vegas, and we can't bring another team on in another market until we give Seattle back a basketball team. Mm-hmm. So it looks like there's going to be Seattle and Las Vegas expanding back into the NBA fold. So I am very happy to hear that, Bert. Seattle has one of the best fan bases in the world. I was really sad to see the Seattle Supersonics go. They are a historic franchise in the NBA. It's well-deserved that they are returning. As for Las Vegas, that was going to happen.
Needs to happen. They need more professional sports in Vegas. And here's why. So the Raiders moved to Vegas. The Golden Knights, they get introduced to the NHL 3 years ago. One more team in Vegas. They're building out. They're a baseball team shy of building out another four-team city. Seattle's regaining their four-team status. They had hockey way, way back in the day. Now they're bringing it back. You get the Seattle Kraken that's starting in the 2022 season. Hopefully the same will go for this new Seattle team yet to be named, but I would love it if they brought back the Sonics again. Yes. And then, you obviously have the Seahawks and you have the Mariners there too. So this is certainly shaping up to be both of them within the West too. I mean, two powerhouses within the West when we're talking about four team cities, but love to see it. I'm actually very curious from, I know you are too, from a branding, mascot, design perspective, what are they going to come up with? Of course, Seattle should pay homage to their heritage before, but I wouldn't mind it if they switched it up a bit. And then Vegas, I mean, what are they going to go with? They have the Raiders, they have the Golden Knights. What do you think they could possibly go with for a basketball team?
I hope they do a neon Las Vegas. Like, so the WNBA team that's already there is the Aces. So I would love for them. I always believed NBA and WNBA team that share a city should always coincide. So I would love for them to go with a card theme. Mm-hmm. Something like that. I don't know, but
the Dealers.
The Dealers or the Aces. No, they're not the Aces, but like the Blackjacks or the Kings. Or they already have the Sacramento.
Not the Craps.
Not the Craps. Yeah, don't do the Craps. Charlie Green, what's up, man? Let's go, Giants. You think the Giants can make the playoffs? No, I don't.
No, it's not looking good.
It's not looking good, and it's not really. It depends on Daniel Jones. Colt McCoy just can't do it. The defense is starting to fall apart. I thought there was a stretch there that I thought the Giants were going to pull away. But then Washington's defense came. And now and as that happened, the New York offense is falling apart. And yep. The defense was never that good anyway, but they were good enough to not get blown out. But now they're not even doing that. They can't stop anybody.
You know, even if they do finish up when they get up to that first round matchup, it's going to be like, why even show up to the playoffs? Because they're not built for a playoff run this year. They're just not.
They would be the last. I mean, well, no, they would be the fourth seed. They would play the fifth seed, and I'm assuming the first wild card team is better than the whatever the NFC East team is going to be.
Yeah, they probably would have a better record than them by the time they finished out too.
I'm thinking it's probably the Buccaneers. So
it looks like it's shaping up to be the Bucs, unless for some reason Chicago. The Bucs would have to lose to Chicago. The Bucs would have to lose out. Chicago would have to win out. That would be it. Yeah.
Yeah. Brandon says the Vegas slot teams. Hey, I'm already starting the bandwagon. There shouldn't be any nicknames. Everybody should be the Vegas basketball team.
Vegas basketball team.
That's just Seattle hockey team. I'm ready. I'm done with nicknames. That's my Christmas gift to sports. We're getting rid of nicknames. Everything's offensive. Colts are offensive to horses. Bills are offensive to buffaloes. All right. I'm sick of it. I'm just offended by everything. So everybody should just be the city sports team, whatever it is. Okay. The Buffalo football team. I love it. Let's go. Let's go, Buffalo football team. Print the shirts. Do you think the Mets will do it? Hell yeah, I think the Mets are going to do good this year, man. We're going to spend some money. I think all our primetime players are going to get back. We didn't swing the bat very well. And we were too sporadic. I think with new ownership comes new excitement. I think players are going to come prepared to get it popping. Last year was kind of a misnomer for a lot of teams. I mean, you've seen the Marlins somehow, through the grace of God, make a run and get into the playoffs after their abysmal start. It was just a weird year. We'll see. I think new ownership always brings that extra jolt, and then we got to see if it's sustainable after that. But I do think if the Mets can get some consistent pitching, Noah Syndergaard will be back. I think they'll be okay, because we have the offensive talent on the bat side. Just need to get the pitching going, and I think we'll be good.
I don't think they'll be good.
Really?
I think they're going to be the same old Mets. Not in a bad way, though. I just think, despite the fact that they're going to have new money, and let's see if they go out and they buy some players, I think there's still new ownership, brings new management. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just think they're going to need time, or at least you're going to see the Mets struggle in the first half of the season, and they may gel afterwards, but I think it's going to be, and because of that, I think they're going to be very middle of the pack. Now, there's plenty of people listening that wish I was wrong. Or at least didn't say that from my opinion standpoint. I'm not expecting anything out of the ordinary from them.
Right. Well, we'll see. I know that much. Mets are going to be better than the Yankees, buddy.
Well, let's see. Hopefully we'll get this DJ LeMahieu deal done, because I don't know what's taking so long. Let's take forever signing our biggest player. And now Toronto's entering the conversation too, when it comes down to, being interested in him. So if we keep DJ, I think we'll be good. I'm going back to my gifts. I want to give the Yankees the gift of health this year and signing DJ LeMahieu. Please do that.
Boo. Boo. Mets are going to get real Muto from Philly, so don't worry about it. We'll be all right. So that concludes. Yeah, we hope Vegas gets a team. I hope they do something really cool with that. We will keep an eye on that. That was very good news that I heard today down the scuttlebutt in the NBA circles that I heard from a couple of reliable sources, and it's making its way around. So as we wind down the show, we have Bucket of Doom coming up. But first, we want to do something, as Christmas is a few days away, Bert. The Christmas movies are coming out in full force. Hallmark was about a week early this year. HBO seemed to be about a week early this year, because there's nothing to do. People are shopping online and watching Christmas movies. So we will get into our top five Christmas movies. So how do you want to do it? Do you want to do 5, 5, 4, 4, or do you want to just run through your five and I'll run through my five?
I'll run through my five. You can run through your five.
Okay, go for it.
So I'll start with five. A lot of people don't think of this. I think it's absolutely hilarious. And I love it because of Ryan Reynolds, but Just Friends. I think is a great Christmas movie. It takes place around Christmas. It's infused with Christmas all around. And Ryan Reynolds, I think, is he's one of the funniest human beings on the planet and a great actor. So it makes my top five list. Number four, and I rewatched this week with my daughter, and it's The Santa Claus, the original with Tim Allen. Yeah. None of the sequels a part of it too, because it was a genius story idea. It still does hold up over time. Despite the fact that you know me as a parent poking plot holes through it about like, why would you leave your kid on the roof like that? Nicey roof. But but overall, I mean, still good and still some good one-liners from Tim Allen. Number three, sappy one, but it gets me every time. Love Actually. I'm not afraid to admit, love that movie. Not a lot of people do, but I think it hits a spot. Great casts, has some comedy thrown in there, and of course some touchy-feely stuff to really get me around the holidays. Number two, Christmas Vacation. It's a staple. You can't not go throughout the season and watch it. Chevy Chase in his heyday throwing comedy haymakers. And then lastly, and it's because it's something I watch nonstop from Christmas Eve into Christmas Day, that's The Christmas Story. A Christmas Story?
A Christmas Story. Overrated.
Get out, nah.
Bro, Christmas Story is so overrated, bro.
Some may think, not for me. I can't get enough of it. It's just
I get it.
On repeat. And I'll be doing the same in 2 days. I can't wait.
So I'm not a big Christmas guy, but I do love Christmas movies. And I do think Christmas Story is overrated. However, I do get, like, there is something magical about it. I get that. It's one of those things you have to watch and you see it. I watched it like once or twice and I'm like, all right, it's okay. But it's not something I'm watching every year, like the movies on my top five list. And on my top five list at five, of course, it's a controversial movie. People don't really believe it's a Christmas movie, even though it's absolutely a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
A grisly old guy just trying to save the city all over the place with explosions. And that movie, of course, is Batman Returns. That's right. Batman Returns, Christmas movie.
I would never classify that as a Christmas movie.
Why? The whole plot of the movie happens at the Christmas cell. It's all decked out in Christmas, man.
I get it. I just never thought of it before. I never made that connection, but
now everybody likes to get on and say Die Hard is a Christmas movie. The climax of the movie was at a Christmas gala. The mayor thing, everything was about Christmas. Oswald Cobblepot stealing Christmas toys and doing everything like that. Yeah, Mike, you tell him. We'll tell him. Let's see. The Gringo, Jack Frost, Elf. So number four, Elf is on my list.
Yeah. And Home Alone. Wow.
Damn, he took two of mine. So I'll just get into it quick. Elf is number four, and Home Alone was number three for me.
Okay.
Home Alone is one of those movies. Now, Home Alone is definitely greater than A Christmas Story. I'll watch Home Alone 1,000 times before I watch A Christmas Story.
Two different movies, twice. Hey, whatever. Opinion.
It's just in terms of Christmas, I feel more. Man, when his mom shows up at the end, and you see that look, like he was treating his mom like shit the whole time.
Oh, yeah.
And then, you know, he finally gets to see her. Then, you know, you get to see that. So, and then number two, it gives me the feels big time.
I will say, before you go on, they made two Home Alones with Macaulay Culkin. First, he was left at home when the family went to fucking Paris. And the second time, they lost him in New York. At no point did anybody call Child Protective Services to get this kid taken away from his parents. Do it once. Okay, maybe I get it. I hope that never happens to my kids. But a second time, someone should be called. That's all I'm saying. And I'll leave it at that.
Number two on my list. Friday After Next.
Great. Oh, that's right.
I watch it every year. I love Friday After Next. Has all the classic characters in it. Cat Williams is hilarious in it. Even though I'm not a Terry Crews fan, that was back when Terry Crews was still black and cool. And love that about him. And then number one, even though National Lampoon's didn't make my list, even though I love that movie, I have to go with the old classic, the original Dr. Seuss's The Grinch. I have to watch that every year. I love it. Just the music. Not the Jim Carrey version. That version sucked, even though I love Jim Carrey, but the original cartoon version of The Grinch. So, of course, Batman Returns, Elf, Home Alone, Friday After Next, and The Grinch are my top five Christmas movies.
Damn, I'm about to go watch Batman Returns the night after this.
Watch Batman Returns. It's absolutely, it's
got the best Batman in it. Michael Keaton.
It, it, Yeah, Ben Affleck's probably better.
Affleck's a close second. I'll give that to you.
He is a close second. But it's so a lot of people say Die Hard, and I'm not going to argue that Die Hard isn't a Christmas movie, but Batman Returns, if you're going by that criteria and defending Die Hard as a Christmas movie, Batman Returns has more Christmas in it than Die Hard. So if you're going to go that route, then I'm going with Batman Returns because it's fucking Batman. And I'm taking Batman over John McClane any day of the week. So as we wrap it up, Bucket of Doom. Last week we had, let's see, Corey lost. He had the Panthers. He's 8-3. I lost. I had the Saints. I am now 8-3. Burt picks up the dub, 7-4, climbing, creeping to that number one spot.
Needed that.
Mike picked up the dub with the Seahawks. He's now 7-4. Ty, not technically out of it. I mean, he's if there's a three-way tie, we're going to have to figure something out at the end here. He is now 5-6. He's going to have to run the table now.
And, he's going to have to win out.
You guys are going to have to lose out. Or somebody has to lose out. So one of you or Mike have to lose out, and Ty has to win out. And we may have a tie here. So we'll see what happens. It's getting interesting. I am comfortable in saying that I'm going to win this thing, but I want to have the undisputed number one title in the Bucket of Doom. And next week, guys, for all our listeners out there, I'll make a graphic and I'll put it out there, but we will be doing a Bucket of Doom Eliminator Challenge where a select few of you will get to pick from the Bucket of Doom, and the winner, we will decide on the prize. It'll probably be a mixture of merch and cash or Cash App, because I'm not delivering money to you guys in COVID era, and I live in North Carolina. But we'll figure something out, something nice to do for some of our fans. So if you want to be involved in that, be on the lookout, be ready to send a message or an email to us, because we're only going to have 14 people doing it, and five of us are part of the network. So actually six, because we're going to count Josh in it. And here we go. Bucket of Doom time. Let's see. Who should go first? Oh, the guys weren't here. Yeah, we'll do that. Corey lost, so we'll give him the first pick in the Bucket of Doom. So that's the Carolina Panthers.
Again, he had them last week.
He had them last week. Corey.
They're going against the Washington football team.
Oh, I didn't do that on purpose, Corey. I promise you I didn't. We will go Mike and Ty one. We'll go with Mike. Nice little rummage here. Mike has the Philadelphia Eagles.
Ooh, the birds. They got the Cowboys this week, and that'll be a good matchup.
That's going to be a good matchup. Jalen Hurts is playing well. The Eagles, you know, sadly, Eagles are not out of it. Sadly, the Cowboys are not out of it. Unbelievable what's happening in the NFC East. Ty. All right, Ty. You need this, buddy. Hopefully, I get you a good one. The LA Rams, who just dropped one inexplicably to
they got the Seahawks this week, so.
Well, Ty, looks like you'll be doing something embarrassing. Let's see. Burt, I'll go with you. Not the Bills. The Kansas City Chiefs, Burt.
Let's go.
I'm sure you're going to keep it. I'm not even going to keep them.
Yeah, they got the Falcons, but I'm still going to keep them.
Yeah. That's easy money. Let's see. Whew, let's go. The Chicago Bears. Ah, damn it.
Who got the Jags?
God damn, man.
I'd keep them. But
yeah, I'm gonna keep them. It's the Jags. I'm ragging on Mitch Trubisky, but he has been playing well. I'm teasing the Chicago fans. I think he shouldn't be starting, but I'm terrified what's in the bucket, so I'm going to go ahead and keep the Chicago Bears.
There's a lot of bad teams still left in that bucket.
There's a lot of bad teams. Yeah. That's where I'm at with it.
He could have pulled the Giants. He could have pulled the Cowboys. He could have pulled the Steelers, the Jets.
Yeah. I mean, I know the Bengals just picked up a good win, but I could have pulled the Bengals. I'm not trusting
Niners,
them.
Pats, Raiders. Keeping.
I'm good on that. That's a good helmet. The Chicago Bears are a pretty good helmet, so I think I will stick with that. So that does it for this episode. Do you have anything else that we forgot?
Merry Christmas, everyone.
Hey, wait, real quick. How do you feel about the realignment and putting all the Canada teams in one division in hockey?
Yeah, so the NHL confirmed a 56-game season. It's going to happen. They realigned, and all from what I'm hearing, I don't think I've seen official reports yet, is you're only playing teams within your division 8 times each team. So, yeah, because I think each division has the same amount of teams in itself. So, yeah, I mean, look, it is what it is. I think whatever it takes to get the season done, but this just for playoff purposes, it puts teams at a complete disadvantage from not seeing other teams. And also, when you're putting teams like, for example, our division in the East here with the Rangers, I mean, they're going up against some like solid competition between Pittsburgh and Washington, you know, even the Islanders and Philadelphia. So, I mean, they have good young cores and are ready to get back to it. But yeah, the Canadian division is going to be a wild one too. It's interesting. I mean, I doubt basketball isn't doing the same and keeping within the bit. They're just letting them play like a normal schedule.
They are. So obviously Canada's not letting people into their country. So that's mm-hmm. why NHL did what they did. The Toronto Raptors are the lone Canadian team in basketball. They're actually now relocating to Tampa for mm-hmm. this season. So they will be the Tampa Raptors for at least this season. Hopefully next season we'll be done with this COVID thing and everything will be right in the world. So we got one more show before 2020 exits. We will try to do another special thing where we review the year in review. We'll reflect on the growth of Stuff About Sports. Bert, this ride has been crazy. I mean, we went from interning and helping out on the former show on the network, and now we're like doing this thing with thousands of people, you know, interacting with us on a weekly basis. And I think it's been a great ride. Canada only 7 teams. How's that going to work?
Yeah, I don't know. That's a good one. Not sure.
We're rolling with the punches, Kaz. I promise you, man. We're rolling with the punches.
I'm just glad they confirmed that we're actually going to have a season, because before it was like, let's see if we can get it done. But
Brandon, Merry Christmas, brother. I appreciate it. Appreciate all the love. Please make sure I'll make sure you're in the Eliminator Challenge. You've been riding with us from day one. So
yeah, absolutely.
If you want to do the Eliminator Challenge, just hit me up and we'll make sure I pencil you in. That's true. Canada, very man. True, they know that they're like the Garden of Eden up there, and everybody wants a piece, and they're gonna keep that thing exclusive, man. They're not,
they're
not playing games. So anyway, we got one more show before 2020's up. The godforsaken year has been awful, but I think Stuff About Sports and the Give Us a Shot Network has been great to us. Speaking of the network, I forgot to mention at the very beginning, we are presented by the Give Us a Shot Network. And if you are looking to start a podcast or you want to just join the network and be part of this growth, head on over to www.giveusashot.network. And if you just want a buffet item of just a bunch of dope ass podcasts, you have Stuff About Sports, you have The Divide, and you have Mall Practice, which is dropping tonight. You have a new Smarkout Club if you're a wrestling fan, which is dropping tonight. And we're working on another special podcast, a couple young ladies that are joining the network, and they are going to do really special things, and I think they're going to take us to the next level, maybe. So we will see. Until then, everybody, please have a wonderful, safe, joyous, merry Christmas, and we will talk to you next week.
Merry Christmas, everyone. Be good.